So, mein Name ist Harald. I studied electric engineering and computer science in a former life. My first serious contact with open source was before and on PHP documentation. It's also in a former life by now. So, then I switched to working for MySQL as a support engineer. I lived through the acquisition by Sun. Then left and continued to do the same job.
Das geht nicht mehr. Ich gebe
erstmal das, dann klären wir das gleich.
My motivation for working on printing was.
Nehmen wir das. Okay.
Was that. As I already showed on the previous slide, I had been working with OpenStreetMap for quite a while already. And in all my previous flats, I had printed maps of the town I was in my flat. So now I wanted to have my own printed map on the wall too. And I got the opportunity to buy a large printer, DIN A1 in Germany, 24 inches wide roll paper for the international formats. For a pretty good price. It was a model that got out of production, so I could get it cheap. And so finally I could have my own printed map on my wall. Sorry for the bad photo quality, but you get the idea. So what can you do if you want to print OpenStreetMap data? Simplest plan is just take a screenshot, but that does not really look good on paper. At least not on large printers, unless you have a very large screen to take a screenshot from. So we need a better way to do this. And there is, even on the OpenStreetMap site itself, is a better way. And if you click on the share icon in the icon bar, you can use the image download. And there you can select a rectangular area and have that exported as PDF or as SVG. So that already gives you better results. But problem is this is still, okay, first advantages, it supports PNG and SVG and PDF. So it is printable in the scalable formats. And you can now select the area you want to print. You do not have to rely on what your screen currently shows. But you only get the default OSM rendering style. Even the additional styles you have on the osm.org page, like the humanitarian style or the transportation style, are not offered here for printing or for downloading. And it's pretty hard to get this rectangular box to the right aspect ratio of the paper you want to print on. So you always have white borders at some sides. And it's even harder to find the right scale factor for the paper you print. So either your pixels get too big or too small, or the letters get too small or too big. And some of this you can work around by then taking the downloaded format and use some program to edit it further, like cutting off edges until it fits on your paper. But it's not really very satisfactory. So I was looking for an even better way, and one of the things I did was I checked out several websites that offered to you to create PDFs from OpenStreetMap data you selected on the screen. And the best one I found was MapOSmatic. That is a project that offers you several nice things. So it's based on Mapnik, so it uses the same renderer as OpenStreetMap itself. And you can select a rectangular area, or you can select a city name. And if that city name is known, it will automatically select an area that fits the whole city. I will show that in action in a minute. And you have several predefined paper formats. So if you select a certain paper format, you get a good resolution and a good zoom factor that fits this paper size, at least in theory. And you can have more than one style sheet installed. So you do not get all the styles necessarily that OpenStreetMap.org has, but you get more than just the standard style. And if you want to, you can have it also generate a street index on the side or on the bottom of the map. So it finds all the street in the area that is printed and creates an index and also looks for some special points of interest like schools and churches and puts these on the map too. That looks like this then here on the bottom. So this was also already a pretty good solution, but it still had some issues. Ah, okay. It can do single page documents and multi-page or atlas-like booklets. And again, PDF and SVG, so it's scalable. But now for the disadvantages. It is not really maintained anymore. It has not seen much love in the last 3 years, which is not an issue by itself, but also the OSM style used on the website and for printing is also 3 years old by now. And we had a lot of changes in the style, like in Germany, trunk roads are not green anymore now. There they still are. And worst of all, the website has been offline for long periods of time during the last year, sometimes several weeks in a row. So you can't really rely on this if you want to use this service. And so as this is an open source project and it is on GitHub, you can install your own instance, but as it is so old by now and unmaintained, you need a pretty old installation, a pretty old Linux distribution to install it on, if you go by the instructions. And then you have to compile a lot of stuff yourself that is actually now available in Debian and Ubuntu in sufficiently new versions. So that should not longer be necessary. And so I've set up my own instance now. I tried to get everything running on current software. And most of the dependencies it has can now be solved by simply using the standard Ubuntu or Debian packages. There's only one component where I need to compile myself because there's the bug fix in there that is only fixed in a newer version that does not work with the things. So, and also by running my own installation, I could use the current OpenStreetMap style. Yeah, run with all up-to-date tools. And I also added a feature to actually select two style sheets. So you have a basic style sheet that does the map. Then you can put an overlay above this. So if you want to use the standard style, just want to add some small details, you do not have to copy the original style and modify it. You just put a second layer on top, give that a transparent background, and be done with it. And I fixed a lot of small things on the way that I noticed being wrong. So this is the list of style sheets I currently have installed. Like this is standard OSM style. So we are here. And there's also a style that comes with the Map-O-Smatic. And there's some other Mapnik styles that are openly available, and I tried to install as much of them as I was able to. This is my final one, the Open Topo map that it looks like our official topographic maps in Germany. The installation is not complete now because it is missing contour lines for hide information. But it also already looks pretty good. And I currently provide two overlay style sheets. One is also one I found on GitHub that adds more detailed rendering for golf courses. I'm not especially interested in golf, but it was the only public one I could find. And I created one myself that I use for printing fire hydrants on top of the map. Is this readable? So there's not much in it. So this is what the complete style sheet looks like, but the only important points are, there's a style tag that says what should be put on the map that only has one point symbolizer. And in at these points, it should just put a firehydrant.png file on the map. So it's just an image file that should be placed. And the second part is a layer. And in this layer, I say use the style we defined above. And the data comes from this database query. So from the table of points of interest, I just want to have all nodes, all points that have emergency equals fire hydrant as a tag. Yes, so the question was, this is the old Mapnik XML format of style sheets. There is a newer one, Kato CSS, but still to use Kato CSS for Mapnik, you first have to convert the Kato CSS into XML, and only then it can read it. And so here because this is such a small style that only has one feature, I just used XML right away. So this is the final result then. We have a base map layer and we have a lot of fire hydrant icons on top of it. And what happened? Yeah, let's quickly switch things now. It doesn't like me. Okay, so this is what the web interface looks like. You can either hold in typo day. Oldinghausen. Yes. This is the village I was born in. It's not too large, so it renders quickly. And yes. I don't know why the lookup takes so long right now, but it works. So I first can select either a city name, or if we switch back here once more, can also select not enough hands. So to select an area here, you need to press Control and move the mouse, and I can't do this with one hand on the touchpad. So let's continue by This is something that should be fixed. It should remember. Yeah, I tried St. Augustine, but it doesn't seem to like blanks in city names. So yeah, another bug report. I I wrote St. Augustine is this is how it is rendered on OpenStreetMap.
Oh,
okay, there we are. So next we can choose between a full page layout. Let's see if I can get this a bit larger. Yeah. So there's full text layout, a full page layout with a street index on the bottom or on the right hand side or without street index. And there is a multi-page layout option too that prints a little atlas. And then next you can select which style sheet to use and which overlay if you want one. Now it calculates the optimal paper sizes. I hope it does. Yes. So the smallest paper format it could fit on would be DIN A5. But you can also select bigger formats up to A0, which is a square meter. I could add that. And there's also some international formats too. And you can also select portrait or landscape mode. Then. What if I wanted to create a banner on the size of this screen? These paper formats are just defined in a configuration file, so you can add bigger ones if you want to. It's just a arbitrary pre-collection of sizes. No, you can't edit it via web interface. It's predefined. But what I will show you how to do your own instance of this, and then you can change it.
So you have a printer format, of course,
So the question was, when you have a roll printer, can you say I want infinite lengths? I want to print the whole roll. I haven't tried this yet. But as soon as this does not fit on any of the predefined paper sizes anymore, it just says you, this is so many centimeters by so many centimeters. Take this or change the size.
Would it be possible to have a stitched printer? So let's say I have an A3 printer and I want it to make it really big. Say maybe A3x3
No, it is not. So the question was, is it possible to have it stitched so you have several pages printed out and then you glue them together to form a bigger one. This is not possible here, but it is possible when you, for example, use Acrobat Reader. It at least offers that. I don't know if it really works out well, but it offers to print a document on several smaller pages.
There is
other open source software for this too. I didn't get the name, but I have to confess, I'm using Acrobat Reader anyway, because for some of the map styles, the other PDF viewers, the open source ones, seem to have some glitches where some areas that are supposed to be filled by a pattern come out black. So I'm using a Acrobat Reader anyway for the large prints, and then it's a feature that's already in there. So now, when you think you have everything figured out, you press generate and wait. Usually doesn't take that long. Do we still have network? Yes, so now it has submitted the print job to a background daemon, and it waits for the background daemon to complete. So we see here there is a bar that is not for the actual print job. It just shows how many jobs are in the queue. Oh, it's already done. So this page refreshes every 10 seconds. It's not done yet. But when this number here goes to go zero and the blue bar is full, then your job is actually rendering now. You still see the button still says rendering, but it should not take much longer now. It shouldn't. Famous last words, but but I. How's the background rendering going on? I'm going to cheat a bit now. I have to prepare this in case the network doesn't play nice. So this is the final result as a PDF rendered for paper size A1, which is half a square meter. This is this size here. And if you select a city name, then it also highlights the actual city area, and everything around gets a slight shadow overlay. And here we have the street index I already showed. And I also prepared the multi-page booklet output. So if you select multi-page, you only get the choice of A4 or A5, which is half of A4, and letter size paper. But where's page down? And don't be confused by the second page being empty. It's in very small print here, second page is intentionally left blank. So it's not the renderer that it's broken. Then it gives you an overlay view page, which part of the map is on which actual atlas page. And then you have the pages always showing which page number is to the left, to the bottom. This is the upper left page, so there is no left or up page. And this continues for every page until you have the street index now in the end on one or more separate pages. So if you want to have your vacation city printed as a booklet beforehand, before you get there or something like that, this is also a nice option, even if you have a small printer. So back to the right screen. So now rendering has finished, and the web service even renders SVG, it's actually in gzip compressed SVG here, a PDF and PNG at the same time. So you don't have to choose up front, you can now download which format you want. And you also have a list of someone used it in between. You have a list of previous print jobs here, and you have a reload button so you can recreate the map if something has changed, or you have the style sheets. You don't have to enter all this information again, what you want to print. You just say recreate the map once more. So much for the hands-on. Too many virtual screens. So this is more or less the Map Osmatic tool as I was it when I started hacking on it, and what I directly added to its web interface. But I also did a slightly different thing. I created an alternative front end And this is especially meant to create neighborhood plans where you have a map and a list of points of interest that you want to mark on the map and have explained in a sidebar. So it's a bit like the markers you can put on Google Maps or on UMap if you want to use it with OpenStreetMap. And so here you can place icons on markers on the map, give them a name, pick one of the pre-selected icons, and also give these markers categories. So each category has a different color here. And when you're done, you click on the pinned icon in the lower left. And in the background, it uses the Map-O-Smatic renderer and creates a PDF, but one that does not have the street index here, but the names and the icons of the markers you have put on the map previously. So we use this for creating neighborhood maps for refugee shelters in Germany, so that the people that were put in gym halls or other places would at least have a rough idea where the local transportation and the next pharmacy and shops in the neighborhood would be. So, what's the time? Okay. So I'm running my own instance, as the main instance was offline too often, and as I wanted to add my own features and styles. And so maybe you want to too, because you maybe don't want to rely on my instance. Or as my instance currently doesn't cover the full world, but only Germany, for capacity reasons, you may want to have prints for another country. Yep, or maybe you want to have the service running offline, so you don't have it slowed down by slow network. Or maybe, as we had with these refugee neighborhood maps, maybe you don't even want to have these maps online, because you don't want to publish that here is some shelter or something. Or maybe you want to help fix bugs and add features. Or maybe you just want because you can, like I did. So as this is a Mapnik renderer-based solution, you obviously need Mapnik itself. And you need at least one Mapnik style file. Doesn't have to be in the XML format. It can be in the newer Kato CSS format, which can be converted into the older format. And many of the style files that are publicly available, like the standard OpenStreetMap style, need additional files. So, for example, coastlines or height information that comes from the NASA Space Shuttle radar data for putting on contour lines, because we do not have much height information in OpenStreetMap itself. And some of these styles also require a lot of other additional files. And you need OpenStreetMap data itself and import that into a PostGIS database. So this can be OpenStreetMap XML files or the newer, more compact protobuf file format. Usually you need OSM to PGSQL as an import tool for that. So it's a lot of stuff to install, and the original installation instructions were not pretty good. I updated them, but there may still be bugs in there. Can only say it works for me. So what if we could automate all this? So the next thing I created was a Vagrant file that does all the installation steps automatically, and you end up with a virtual machine that is ready to use with the web interface up and running. So everything that is needed is installed. The PostGIS database is set up and pre-configured. It is already provided with the data file you put into this VM directory before you first fire it up. Currently, it has to have a fixed name, data.osm.pbf. That is going to change eventually, but renaming a file is not that much thing. So, and it makes sure that the render daemon and the web server and the web interface is up and running. So all you need to do is check out the JIT project for this, change into the directory you just checked out, download some OpenStreetMap data file. For example, geofabric.de has extract for Florian, every country or most countries?
A lot of countries.
Yes, for yeah, for
you can just
say yes, I think they have all countries or as separate files. They definitely have for bigger countries like is Germany big? Okay, for Germany it is even split down to the state level and for some states to the district level. And once you have your file in place, so here I saved it to the right file name right away, you say Vagrant up, and then it takes a while and downloads a lot of things. So I tried it on the laptop this morning and took 90 minutes to complete. But all of this is automatically, so... it was only for... the data I used was only for the district I'm from, but the data size is not the most important thing. What takes time? What takes time is I need to compile Mapnik myself, because that's the one component that has one bug that needs to be patched. That takes a lot of time. And all the extra downloads for coastline files and that takes also a lot of time, at least in the network here. And the actual import of the district I'm from only was like 10 minutes of this time. Complete import of Germany on this laptop, but on the laptop itself, not in a virtual machine, takes about 1.5 hours. The limiting factor actually for importing is memory, not time. As long as you have not enough memory, it is fast. When memory runs out and you have to cache things on disk, then it gets slow. Yes, on a virtual machine it is... Yeah, the question was how running on a virtual machine affects this, right?
Or,
When running on an I/O machine, you have I/O issues. Yes. So what I did here is the actual database data is not in the virtual machine. It is in a shared folder on the host. So you may still have I/O slowdowns, but you at least don't run out of space in the virtual machine, because the typical Vagrant base boxes are not big enough for this, and extending their size is tricky. So just mount a host folder and have the data in there. Yep. Yeah, so that much for the tools I use and I created.
Oh.
Didn't create, but modified. There are also some command line tools that can be used that are front ends to Mapnik. There is Nick to Image is a tool that comes with Mapnik itself. And Nick4 is a similar tool that is standalone and has some slightly improved features. Both also create nice maps, use the same style files, but as they are command line tools, you have to figure out all the necessary parameters, map coordinates, style sheet passes and everything. So this is not for end users. The web interface is nice for end users, but both these tools are also installed in the virtual machine image, so you can use the database imported there and the style sheet imported there to play with these if you want to. Did I skip one? No. Then there is a more powerful tool, that is QGIS, that also can be used to do great prints, but it is not only meant for printing. It's a complete full stack geo tool. So printing is just one of its aspects, not even the main one. and not of the, one of the trivial ones. So you have quite a learning curve there. And I couldn't motivate myself to use it yet. I may start now because I discovered that MapNIC can't rotate maps. So I have one case where I want to have a map where north is not up, not up, but the direction you're looking to is up, and QGIS can do that. MapNIC currently can't. There was a patch for that, but it was lost, apparently. And there's also an application called Mapperative that is a .NET application that also runs on Linux. It provides a basic GUI, so you sort of see what you're doing, but you still have to interact with it in a command window, so you still have to type a lot. It also produces a nice output, but the problem with it is free to use, but it is not open source. So if you find problems with it or want to add features, you can't. And it has last been updated in probably 2013. That was the time when the last update on the web page was. When you download it, the download archive has a timestamp of 2015, but I think it just recompiled it at that point, but it didn't add anything. So this is also sort of abandonware by now. And the good thing about it is it can process OSM XML files right away, which also makes it slower if you have large extracts. But if you only have a small area you want to process, you don't have to do database import before. It can also merge bitmap tiles into your map, so you can use bitmaps provided by some tile server and then add your own rendering on top. And it also has direct support for this NASA SRTM height data, so it can add hill shading and contour lines. But it has menu items for downloading OSM stuff. Both of them are broken by now. Both of them seem to use outdated URLs. So you have to manually download XML, then load it into this tool. And it looked nice at first, but I don't really like to use it. And it also only produces PNG and scalable vector graphics. So if you want to have a printable PDF, you first have to convert the S4G into PDF. But that's one of the smallest issues with it. And as we're on that, what I originally did was I first created SVG files with the standard version of Map-O-Smatic. And for these refugee neighborhood plans, I then used Inkscape to add all these markers manually using Inkscape as an open source web editor. And this turned out to be actually pretty painful because Inkscape isn't a very nice tool, but with the amount of data produced by the SVG renderer, it became almost as slow as I remembered CorelDRAW to be on a 386 with 2 megabytes, which was my first drawing program ever. So my first attempt to solve this was just to reduce the style file by removing stuff I didn't need, like especially house numbers. But still editing was so painful, like you'd drag a marker, it takes a second before it moves on the screen, then you see you moved it too far, you have to move it back, you have to wait another second. That I finally decided to get rid of this and created this web GUI for setting markers that I've shown previous. So this works if you have files for up to maybe A3 papers, so 40 by 30 centimeters. For the A1 format I have, it turned out to be too painful and slow. Yeah. So to summarize, printing OSM data is a bit harder than showing OSM maps on the web. The proper tools to achieve this are all available in OpenForm, but they all require some prior setup, like importing data, setting up style sheets, and using them on the command line is not very comfortable. So exposing the web interface to use them is definitely the right way to use them, I think. And parts of the process to get all this running were very frustrating, but I think the end results were indeed worth it. So that ends my talk, and I'm ready to answer further questions. Yes?
Have you had some experiences in actually printing those files? Say, if you generate a A0 or A1, and does every copy shop take those files and print them without any problems, or
I'm lucky I have an A1 print, so have experience with actually printing the files I generate, like handing them to copy shops to print them. I'm in the lucky situation, I got an old A1 printer pretty cheap, so I can print for myself. But for printing, I just load the files into a PDF viewer, and printing worked with all of them. There was also a small glitch with colors in some of the free ones, so I'm using Acrobat Reader right now. But if you use Acrobat Reader to print a PDF, it works out of the box, at least with the HP DesignJet I have at home. And I've never tried to hand things to a copy shop because...
It shouldn't be much of a problem with PDFs.
Yeah, yeah,
so,
but the...
So I think for coffee shops, it should be the same as when you want to print
both. Yes, so there's no... So there's no special features in these PDFs that should prevent them from being printed.
How much is the A0 printout?
About 50 or 60 bucks if you have really high quality. It depends how much.
Okay, we have a small discussion on prices here. I don't have experience with this, so I can't tell. I can only tell that the printer I bought was, as it was an old model, it was for 450 euros. The current model would be around 1,200, and the material costs for regular paper and the regular inks is like 3 to 4 euros per A1 print, if you do it yourself. Okay, comment from the audience, the Heise CT or IX? This Heise CT magazine, some date last year, had a report on printing large maps, apparently.
Yep. I happened to print an A2 full color map on a quantum paper, and I did it for 18 euros. But 70 euros of it was just for the paper. So you can get a standard print in full color for about 10 euros. And if you want to be fancy with the paper, then just A2.
So that was for A3? For A2. So you have some experience printing doing large prints on A2. Cost about 10 euros for the printing itself and another 7 euros as some high quality paper was requested in this case.
So yeah, nice talk. I really like the way you have the markers on the
Yes, so the question was, or the feature request was to also be able to print directions like route planning. I have been thinking about this, but have not looked into it really yet. But should also be possible, but I don't know yet how to. But great idea, sure. Okay.
with semi-professional or professional use in mind, two features would be essential. I think this is a common scale, like 1 to 25,000 or 1 to 50,000. And the grid, UTM grid, for example, I saw your guys had a kind of grid, but that looked quite individual, like
So the question was, two questions actually. One was, can the resolution be controlled or is it fixed? And the other one was, can you influence how the grid on the map is created, like using an UTM grid? The resolution currently is sort of hard-coded. It tries to get a good zoom factor from the style sheet. And currently it is limited that it tries to always have at least zoom factor 16, which is pretty to the high resolution end. So the resolution is a bit variable, but it can be controlled in the source code. There's just now no interface for changing it. So it's sort of hard-coded, auto-detected. And for the grid, is a very simple thing they put up there just so that you in the index can have this street is in grid square A4. So it's not really any, it's not a latitude longitude grid. It's also not a UTM grid. It's just makeshift just to fit the index and have a certain range of square size. Nothing really professional in there. Can we turn the map so that another direction than north is on top? I already mentioned that in passing a few minutes ago when I mentioned QGIS. No, it is not possible with this rendering stack. There was a feature request for Mapnik a few years ago to support that. There was also a patch on the feature request that was supposed to implement it. Not with very good performance, but with working output. Unfortunately, they moved their bug tracker. They had their own track instance. Then they moved to GitHub. And on the way, the attachments to the bugs were lost. And by now, this is, has been 4 years ago or so. By now, also the mirror of the old system they kept running is also lost. So I've tried to find someone who still has that patch or tried to find the original author of that patch, but so far I couldn't. But yes, that would be very nice, especially for neighborhood plans to say, this is the direction you're looking into when you stand in front of the map, and you don't have to rotate it in your mind because it has north on top. The London city maps you have all over town are made like this, and I wanted to create something like that and found out no, not yet. So, any further questions? We have 5 minutes left for questions. Or we have, okay.
So the answer is how do you expect it to be available? So maybe it takes some time to render a map already. And I don't know, my experience, you showed very first, you can draw this map on the regular OpenStreetMap website.
Yes, this was a question about availability and mentioning that the download service on the OpenStreetMap site is often overloaded. The service I'm running is not as slow as it looked here. This was a bandwidth problem. Usually it renders a single page map in between 10 and 30 seconds. And also the original site was never overloaded by rendering jobs. The problem with the original site was they run a full planet database, and they had that database failed several times. And so they, so you need a lot of disk space, and when something fails, you have to do a full re-import, which can take several days. So I'm only importing Germany right now, which only takes about an hour on that machine. And I just do that more or less on a daily basis. So even if my database instance fails, I have it up and running in an hour again. But so far, I haven't published it much yet, so I don't really know how it will behave under load. But as the maps are queued and then rendered one by one, it has sort of load control. You just may have to wait much longer before you have the final rendering ready. Okay, time for coffee now. Yeah.